You're listening to Boomers Today with your host, Frank Sampson.
Well, welcome to Boomers Today. I'm your host, Frank Sampson. Of course, each week we bring you important and very useful information on issues facing baby boomers, their parents, and other loved ones. And as I do every show, I thank all of you. I thank all of you because so many of you are sharing, whether they be individual podcasts or the entire, all of the podcasts, and sharing them with friends and family, and our listeners are growing organically because of that. So I want to thank you so much for all your support. Many of you listen to the show on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spreaker, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, a lot of them, that, you know, pretty much all the podcast stations you can find us. And but some of you go right to our website at boomerstodayradio.com. So again, thank you so much for all your support. And I know why our listeners are growing each and every day is because we have wonderful guests and that are very educational and on particular subject matters. And today's not going to be any different. We have two guests for you today. First, Dr. James Dunick is a board certified in internal medicine and cardiology. He is a certified professional coder through the American Academy of Professional Coders and is also certified in healthcare quality and management by the American Board of Quality Assurance and Utilization Review Physicians. We also have Dr. Laura Dunick. It's not a coincidence that they have the last name. We've got a father-daughter team here, which is great. She's licensed through the Federation of State Boards of Physical Therapy, specializing in Parkinson's treatment, and is working directly with patients with Parkinson's disease and stroke. So I want to welcome both of you, both Dr. Dunnicks. Welcome to Boomers Today. Really appreciate you joining us.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Thank you.
Yeah, great. So a lot to talk about, you know, Parkinson's, that's going to pretty much be the subject matter here, talking about Parkinson's. So I'm going to, you know, I'll direct questions to both of you, and whoever wants to answer them, go right ahead. But maybe you could just give our listeners kind of an overview of what's happening with Parkinson's, you know, maybe the baseline, where things are at. I know there's work being done each and every day to make it, hoping maybe to help slow down the progression of the disease. And I'm sure there's advances being done all the time. We hear about it. So maybe you could just give us a baseline of where things are.
Sure. I think that's a good way to start. From a statistical or numbers point of view, there are about 1 million people in the United States who carry the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, and each year, roughly another 100,000, so 10%, are added to that list. If we were to include the people that are affected by it, a spouse who's now living with someone with Parkinson's disease, or middle-aged children taking care of an older parent who has Parkinson's disease, you can see how this affects just a tremendous number of people.
Yeah. Right. And typically, we're going to see this affecting more men than women, and also typically more diagnoses as we get older, especially over the age of 50. Usually, you'll get the diagnosis based off of motor symptoms. So you start to present with symptoms of Parkinson's. That could be a wide variety of things, from slower movement, a flat affect, so kind of not as expressive of facial features, a softer voice, smaller handwriting, losing your balance, especially backwards. All of those things may be indicators that may send you to your doctor with concerns. And then they would do some testing to determine whether they thought you might have Parkinson's.
So, you know, there's been a lot of publicity that I probably has helped, you know, with some well-known people that have had Parkinson's. And so it's brought some light, you know, to Parkinson's, which I would think is a good thing. Would you agree when people come out and talk about it?
Yes, absolutely. Some of the people who might have a name you would recognize, a Michael J. Fox, for example, Muhammad Ali, quickly come to mind. But anytime you see the illness talked about, it gives you a chance to talk about how to make the diagnosis perhaps a little bit earlier as opposed to later, getting involved with things that can be done from a treatment standpoint. The diagnosis of Parkinson's can be a little bit tough from the standpoint that they really divide the symptoms into what they call preclinical and clinical. And the preclinical stage, which comes first, has a variety of symptoms from changes in bladder control, anxiety, depression, difficulty with sleep habits. But the problem is that's just present in many, many illnesses. So it doesn't mean you have Parkinson's disease simply because you have some of those preclinical symptoms. So we classically make the diagnosis after the clinical phase sets in, which has a couple of sort of famous things. There's a tremor that is called a pill rolling tremor. As Laura had mentioned, you become less expressive, and that often gets called a mask-like face, where there just isn't as much change in the expressions that you give. Other symptoms would include a classic Parkinson's shuffling gait, where you take very short steps. Your feet don't necessarily come off the ground as high as they might if you were walking with a more normal gait. So all of those things can make the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease more confidently, but now you're also a little bit farther down the disease progression pathway.
Yeah, I think there's a perception that somebody with Parkinson's will have that, maybe that shakiness, maybe in their hands or whatever. And you mentioned kind of the shuffling of the feet. And I happen to know personally a few people pretty well that have been diagnosed with Parkinson's. And I've just noticed that there's differences between them and their symptoms. Can you maybe discuss that? As it's not like it appears to me, again, just as a layman, you know, with a few friends that have it, that there's just, it depends on the person and what their symptoms are. Is that correct?
Certainly. I think with any disease, you're going to have differences in presentation from a lot of different factors. You know, it can affect each person differently. Some people may have a tremor, some may not. Some may have, you know, much more difficulty with their physical mobility, whether it's the shuffling steps, fascinating gait. Some may not have as much of that. And also the disease progress, because it is a chronic and progressive disease. So an earlier diagnosis, you may not have many symptoms that are really physically presenting. And as that disease progresses, you may show more. The kind of list of different things you may see with Parkinson's that we just went through, not everyone will display all of those. You might have one thing, a combination. People who are more severely affected may have majority of them. It really depends on each person. And then, of course, there's also the management for the disease, which is a lot of medication-based and also therapy-based. And the medications may prevent some of the symptoms, but cause their own side effects. So that may also account for a difference in presentation.
What about those that are out there that maybe had a parent or grandparents with Parkinson's? Has there been any studies to show that heredity could have something to do with it or not?
Yeah, that's kind of a tricky area. And this is where, you know, going back to having some of the famous people and coming out and talking about Parkinson's, the money that goes into research when, you know, Michael J. Fox is fundraising for this and getting more awareness is really important, because we still don't know a lot about what actually causes Parkinson's. There's thought to be an environmental and possibly a genetic component, but we don't have really solid, concrete evidence. It's not like other diseases like breast cancer, where you can do genetic testing to see if you're at higher risk. So, you know, certainly it could be involved, but we really don't have concrete evidence saying, yes, this is specifically where that gene is connected.
So Go ahead.
One of the problems with Parkinson's disease and any illness you'd like to prevent, treating it is one thing, but you'd rather prevent it from happening in the first place. So when we look at, say, heart attacks, blocked up heart arteries, blocked up neck arteries, and you have a stroke, obstruction of lower extremity arteries, what they call claudication, when you have pain in your legs with walking, when we look at those, the development of those illnesses, there are what they call risk factors. So tobacco use, high blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes, being over your ideal body weight, et cetera. If we can get a better handle on your risk factors, if we can reduce those, then your chances of getting the illness go down. Nothing goes to zero, but simply your chances of getting the illness goes down. So with Parkinson's, we don't really exactly have those risk factors. We know some of the statistics that men seem to be afflicted more than women. We know that it comes about in older ages rather than younger ages. But from the standpoint of a specific risk factor, lifestyle, something that you could avoid, we don't really know that very well. Interesting, there are a couple of states that have a little bit of a blip up. Oregon, California, Pennsylvania have a little bit of a increase, but that's not really known as to why it is. There has been some suggestion with a variety of potential contaminants with various chemicals. But again, as to being able to completely, authoritatively state, here's the best way to avoid Parkinson's, I don't think we have that as we do with other illnesses. For example, lung cancer, stop using tobacco and you really reduce your risks. So with Parkinson's, we just don't have that as well.
Yeah, so on another note, I just want to clarify, because, you know, we, you know, what our organization, we work with families who have a loved one, not only, you know, we deal with Parkinson's, but, you know, various forms of dementia like Alzheimer's. Is there a correlation between Parkinson's and other forms of dementia?
I am not aware of that. People with Parkinson's have difficulty often communicating because of a variety of issues associated with Parkinson's. The hand tremor can become so difficult, so problematic that it's difficult to even eat or drink, hold a cup of coffee. It's a problem in writing or using a computer keyboard for many people. So it really is an illness that tremendously involves each individual's support structure. And it's one of the focuses, I think, on physical therapy, because you'd really like to have the patient be at home as long as is possible, independent as long as is possible, and avoid some of the complications of Parkinson's disease, for example, falling.
Right. Okay, good. So we're going to take a quick 30-second break, I promise, just to recognize our sponsor, and then we come back. Certainly want to learn a little bit more about your practice and all the great things that you're doing. And then maybe talk about the next steps. If somebody's been diagnosed, what are those next steps? So we'll talk about that when we come back. All right. So do you know anybody who may be concerned about an older driver? Well, Senior Care Authority's Beyond Driving with Dignity program is a facilitated self-assessment program for older drivers. This program has been designed to serve as a vital tool to facilitate older drivers and their families as they make the appropriate decisions regarding the future of one's safe driving career. If the individual is a safe driver, an advisor will provide him or her with strategies on how to remain a safe driver as they progress through the aging process. If driving retirement is the appropriate decision, then the individual and their family are offered possible alternatives, resources, and a specific plan to ensure a smooth and successful transition from the driver's seat to the passenger seat. To learn more, you can go to www.beyonddrivingwithdignity.com or call 877-907-8841 to connect with a Senior Care Authority advisor in your area. We're back with both Dr. James Dunick and Dr. Laura Dunick and talking about Parkinson's and new developments and just sharing as much information as we can about this disease. So I'd like to just start out. I know you guys do some amazing work, and so maybe you could talk about that. Certainly feel free to share if you have a website or anything that you'd like to share with our listeners about the wonderful things that you both are doing.
The business that I opened 10 years ago was just to try to help providers, whether you're a physician, a nurse practitioner, physician's assistant, anyone who is seeing patients. The system of electronic health records is simply that every diagnosis needs to be turned into a number, and there are some 200,000 different numbers. So whether you have a sore throat or a heart attack or Parkinson's disease, that has to be turned into a number. And some of the numbers are fantastically specific, having literally hundreds of variations from the initial diagnosis of a heart attack or the initial diagnosis of diabetes. And providers weren't taught this in their training schools. They were taught how to take care of the disease, not how to code and bill for it. So I just try and help providers understand electronic health records, understand these ICD-10 numbers, and how to appropriately use them.
Great.
And then I'm a physical therapist. I work primarily in outpatient. I'm also a certified exercise expert for the aging adult, which is a certification through the American Physical Therapy Association for Geriatric Division. So I work with a lot of Parkinson's patients, but also any patients with neurologic conditions or just your typically aging adult. And in terms of, you know, Parkinson's specific treatments and what you can do to try to slow your disease progression, try to manage the symptoms as they're presenting themselves, there's a lot of different ways to do that. Certainly therapy is going to be one of your best resources. And since it's a progressive disease, I usually recommend people try to go get physical, occupational, or speech therapy, or all three, at least once a year. Do a check-in, kind of see how you're doing. Your therapist can test certain goals and functional measures to make sure that you're not declining or try to help slow the decline. And then there are some really specific exercise techniques. So one of those would be the LSVT Big program. That's Lee Silverman voice technique. It actually started as a speech therapy treatment to help improve the phonetics, to be able to speak louder, be heard more, have better air management when speaking. And that's specific for Parkinson's. And it was so successful that they developed a movement program called BIG with the same kind of general idea of improving the amplitude. A lot of those physical symptoms of Parkinson's come because the brain kind of sees all of the movements as smaller. So you're moving everything smaller, your posture, handwriting, voice, depth, everything is smaller, but your brain thinks you're moving normally. So with therapy, we want to kind of recalibrate what your brain is seeing as normal and get you back to the bigger steps that you're capable of doing. You know, someone with Parkinson's will come in with those really small shuffling steps sometimes, and you just say, okay, go bigger, step bigger, exaggerate, and they're able to immediately correct it. But it's hard to maintain that because the brain thinks that it's exaggerated and it feels abnormal. So a lot of the therapy is kind of a continual management to correct for that amplitude, you know, mismatch. There's also something called rock steady boxing, which are like boxing gyms specific for patients with Parkinson's, where they do different movements, work on reactive balance and strength, step strategies, all of which carry over really nicely to help improve balance, coordination, and decrease your risk of falls.
Wow, that's a lot. So, you know, I know you talk a lot about, you know, physical therapy and therapy, but that's in conjunction with actually various medications as well. Can you talk about that? You know, I know that there's a lot of medications, I believe. That's what I hear, at least from my friends. And they got to take it. You know, they got to take it at a certain time and all that. They can't miss it. And can we talk about that and maybe possible side effects that people could experience?
One of the aspects of Parkinson's disease is that it is not curable. There isn't anything we can do that will make it magically disappear. The next problem with Parkinson's is that it's also progressive. Over time, it will become worse. So we have to start with those two less pleasant facts about the illness. There are a variety of medicines that can help try and reduce some of the symptoms, perhaps try and slow the progression of the illness. There are new medicines being in various phases of clinical trials. There are certain surgeries, some of the deep brain stimulation type surgeries that might also help. I think it might be important to add in that Parkinson's community support can be a big deal. Reaching out to other people who have the illness or have a spouse trying to care for someone with the illness, these community support centers can be very good, and even directing you to physicians who specialize in Parkinson's disease, physicians that might even have the ability to get you in one of the clinical trials in trying to deal with some of the new medicines that might be available in the future over the next few years as their clinical trials continue to progress. I wanted to expand on one of the very important points that Laura made about physical therapy. About roughly 50% of patients that go into a hospital for whatever reason, they will fall within that hospital stay. Fall may be a big deal, like a hip injury, a head injury, could be more modest, like maybe just getting some stitches. But if you've ever been in the hospital yourself, think about the little sticky electrical patches they have on your chest so that the nurses are watching each heartbeat. Maybe you have oxygen, you have an IV, and as you try to stand up and get out of a bed that isn't the normal bed for you and go to a bathroom that isn't in the normal bathroom place, and it's now 2 o'clock in the morning and things are a little dark, you see how easy it is for someone like Parkinson's disease, who is at a fall risk anyway, and now we add all of these other issues when you're in the hospital, and it just becomes a place where the Parkinson's disease patient may suffer an additional event, adding into whatever put him in the hospital in the first place. that's one of the huge pluses of physical therapy and why you want to be so active with that to, again, try to reduce the chances of you falling, try to maintain your independence and the quality of life living at home for as long as is possible.
And going back to those medications, the medications, you know, you do have to take them with specific timing. And as you get close to your next dose, the medication effectiveness may be wearing off some. And so that is something to consider when you're planning your day and you're planning what time you'll take the medications, because as it wears off, your symptoms may exacerbate. So for instance, with therapy, we try to plan that for when your medications are the most effective so you can get the most benefit out of it. Similarly, you'd want to make sure your medications were at their peak performance time when you're doing any physical activities or big exertions, and you're going to have a higher risk of falling or, you know, having more symptom impairment when you have that wearing off effect towards the end.
Great information. So unfortunately, we only have like a couple minutes left, but maybe you could address, I know, Laura, you work with directly with patients with Parkinson's disease and strokes, but we haven't touched really upon strokes. So I don't know if there's a correlation between the two. Maybe you could talk to us about that.
Yeah, strokes definitely have more solid risk factors. And so they're going to have you can be more preventative to an extent with those. From a treatment perspective, we're going to be working on similar things in terms of balance and strengthening and trying to restore function. Both of those are going to be really successful and helpful with therapy. You may or may not need as consistently managed medications with a stroke, you know, depending if you're able to resolve whatever those risk factors were that led to it. So there are some differences, but there's certainly a lot of, there are some similarities, but there's certainly a lot of differences there.
Gotcha. Okay, great. Well, Dr. James Dunnock, Dr. Laura Dunnock, thank you so much for joining us on Boomers Today. Just a wealth of information, and I wish you all the best, and thank you for all the work that you do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, everybody, for joining us on Boomers Today. Please be safe out there, and we'll talk to everybody next week.
You've been listening to Boomers Today with Frank Sampson. To learn more about today's show, visit boomerstodayradio.com and join us next time for another edition of Boomers Today.